I was just reading the HUI CCC Camp newsletter here in Yellow Springs. My name is Bill Jamerson. As she said, I hail from Escanaba, Michigan. I'm 2 hours north of Green Bay in the Upper Peninsula. And, well, 20 years ago, I was making documentary films for public TV, and I was at a museum, and a fellow said, "You got to take a look at this roll of film." And he pulled this out of the vault. It was an 8mm Kodachrome movie showing these young men playing, planting trees. And I said, "Well, those are CCC boys." And I said, "This sounds like a good TV project." So I called the Michigan CCC Museum and asked, "Do these fellows ever get together?" So I wanted to meet them. "Oh, yeah, first Saturday in every June." So I went to this reunion, and there were 500 of these fellows there. They were in their 70s, and they shook my hand. "Best year of my life. Turn my life around. Turn me from a boy to a man." They were so enthusiastic, you couldn't help but feel the excitement and the gratitude. So I went ahead and made a film, and I'm going to show a little 3-minute clip right now. And it'll give you a sense of what they were like, and then the program will have a little bit more meaning for you. This opening scene is of a camp up in the Upper Peninsula, the way it looks today. It's an army camp. But there was no drilling or marching with guns, so they were civilians. You had the long bunkhouses and mess hall, the officers' quarters, equipment building, supply building. Each bunkhouse held 40 or 50 men. One fellow told me they had a chaplain who gave a Jewish, Protestant, and Catholic service. The same man. Very few of these remain today because, as you see, they were not built to last. Just a little idea of what those CCC camps look like. And And I was just reading this. Every camp had a recreation hall with pool tables and ping pong tables. The recreation hall, this is in Yellow Springs, right here. It's being improved as quickly as possible under the direction of the educational advisor. Some of you men will notice things have been very improved with new materials. The canteen is the best we've ever had. The library and educational advisor's office is well equipped with good shelves. The 25 rec hall benches are the best we've ever seen yet. It goes on and on and on, raving about the benches and staining the wood. And then later on, there's a work has just begun on an educational building to be used as a shop, classwork, and study. When completed, it will be available for the use of enrollees who want to do some serious study or work away from the noise of the barracks and rec hall. That has some cute things. Where does Steve Kasigan put all the food he eats? And we'll touch on this later. But these newspapers from the camps are very revealing, and it's just a lot of fun to read. So I recommend you take a look at these after the program. Anyway, getting back to this film. So I went ahead and I filmed these fellows, and the film aired on 58 stations across the upper Midwest on public TV. This was 20 years ago. I went ahead and made a dozen other films, but the C's kept inviting me to their chapter meetings and their reunions. So I wrote some songs for them to entertain these fellas. I've been to 5 national reunions, so I'm going to share a few of those with you today. And then one of the fellows in the film, the very first fellow talking about fighting forest fires, he became a dear friend of mine. He lived just off I-75. He was a few hours from my home. But about once a month, every 3 months or so, if I was driving by, I'd call him up. We'd have lunch together at McDonald's. He had an iron trap memory, full of great stories. And one day after 12 years of listening to his stories, I said, "That's enough. I've got to write a book about you." So I did. And I called it Big Shoulders. That was his nickname. He had, even when he was in his 80s and 90s when I saw him, he had big shoulders for a guy that was 5'9", you know. And his story was he was 16 years old, living in Detroit. He owned one pair of shoes. And the shoes had worn out so bad that they flapped when he walked. The soles came apart from the uppers. And the kids at high school laughed at him. He dropped out of school. He was humiliated. His mother could not afford 20 cents for a shoe cobbler to repair those shoes. So one day, he goes to a shoe store, and out on the sidewalk is a table. And he finds a pair of shoes his size and takes them and runs down the alley where there's a beat cop having a cigarette. He'd been busted a couple other times by this cop. But that officer took pity on him, said, "You know, you're a good kid. We just got to get you out of here." And he recommended to the judge he allowed to be signed up for the CCCs. You had to be 17 to 25 years of age, in good health, single, from a family on relief. You had to weigh 108 pounds. So he's been accepted into the C's. He's 17 years old. He has his uniform on, and he's going around the different merchants, the shopkeepers, knocking on the doors, saying goodbye. "I'm going off to the North Woods. I'm going off." So now he's going over to the produce market to say goodbye to some of the vendors. My favorite vendor was Mrs. Rosenberg, a short Jewish woman who sold the best fruit in the market. The apples and pears she handled came wrapped in tissue paper and were spotless. She saved those tissues and flattened them on the counter. And after she collected a neat pile, she put them in the garbage. My brother and I used to stop by on the way home from school when we were little boys. We would pick through that garbage to find those tissues. We gave them to my mother, who hung them on a nail for toilet paper. When I stopped by the market, Mrs. Rosenberg picked up 2 apples. "Nick, I'm going to miss you. Take these on your trip." "Oh, you don't need to do that. I just came to say goodbye." "Take them. You'll need them on the train." We chatted a few minutes about the CCs, and then as I walked away, I turned around. "Mrs. Rosenberg, there was something I always wanted to ask you." She looked up. "What's that?" "Well, when I was a little boy, I used to go through your garbage." "Well, I know. Well, sometimes when I was going through your garbage, you threw out fruit, and it was still good. What'd you do that for?" She smiled gently. "Well, I put it there for you and your brother." "Well, I know, but why?" she sighed. Because you never begged like the other boys. You never begged. She came around the table and she cupped my face with her hands. Take care of yourself, Nick. Come see me when you get back. Her loving eyes were like dark pools of pond water. Sure, Mrs. Rosenberg, I'll come back someday. That's my character. He might steal, but he wouldn't beg. That's why I wrote the book. Just one story after another that I could not have made up, but he brought it to life. Now, only one out of 10 CC boys had a police record. And those that did were considered on probation. And the CC camp captain sent a report to the police officer from the headquarters. But, you know, 90% of the CCs did not have a police record, and it was voluntary. It was not a boot camp. But I always like to point out that the juvenile crime rate in Chicago declined by 55% between 1933 and 35. These were what we would call today at-risk youth. They were cheating, stealing, lying, getting in trouble. They may not have had a police record. But when you're hungry, when you're really, really hungry, you'll steal. You'll do whatever it takes. And that's what it was like in the Great Depression. Well, let's turn back the clock. It was March of 1933. Franklin Roosevelt came into office with the promise of a new deal for the American people. We don't want to forget that our country was founded on principles of self-reliance, individual responsibility, liberty. And this was a very radical notion for the government to create jobs. And it would not have happened, but it received bipartisan support. People were really in a bind. They had to do something. And this seemed like the best thing at the time. And as I mentioned, it was for 17 to 25-year-old men. You had to come from a family on relief. Now, a family on relief means that you didn't have a dad, because relief only went to mothers who had children. And back then, relief was you take the wagon down to the relief building, and they give you a can of lard, a sack of sugar, some flour, some beans, some government cheese, and then you're on the way out. If you want some fresh fruit, you go climb a fruit tree or pick some berries. You want some meat, you follow those rabbit tracks in the snow. I remember a woman told me, when she was a little girl, her mother was driving down a country road and they saw a woodchuck in the ditch. Her mother pulled over the side, took a gun out of the truck, and bam, that was her supper. It was a different world. The relief agency women would tell the dad to move out of the house if they were starving, so the mother could qualify for food. He would move across the street into someone's house. That they called them boarding houses back then. So these guys came from very, very humble backgrounds. I met a fellow from Chicago who was shipped up to the North Woods of Michigan. He said, you know, we were happy up there. We felt safe. There was no crime, no unemployment, no hunger in our camp. He said the woods around our camp was like a cocoon protecting us from the outside world. His mother wrote him a letter, and she wrote how the neighbor had been evicted from his house. Another neighbor had lost his job. His high school buddy was in jail. It was all bad news. He wrote her back and said, Mom, if you can't write anything nice, don't write at all. I don't want to hear about it. Well, I know they were happy up there because a fellow named Clive Kilgore, a 17-year-old from Nebraska, wrote a song to show his gratitude. And I love to share this because it comes from the heart and the mind of a teenager who was in the seas. They really wanted to work. They really, really wanted to help their families. I can't tell you how many fellows shook my hand. You know, when you're 16 and your family's starving, you'll do anything to help them. Anything. They were grateful. And when they came into camp, by the way, they would often throw their clothes away because they were issued new clothing. Khakis in the summertime, olive drab uniforms in the winter, hats, gloves, mittens, sweaters, overcoats, new boots, work boots, dress shoes, and then blue jeans, They call them dungarees and t-shirts and underwear and socks, belts, the whole everything. They throw their clothes away. They were in such rags. I remember Whitey Iverson in Hay Warden, Iowa. I felt like I was checking into a high-class hotel. Christ, we had running water, electricity, indoor plumbing. Oh, my God. And I asked, what's that under my blanket? Well, those were sheets. I've never seen a sheet before. I'm telling you, it was a revelation for some of these guys. One fellow in Georgia said, when I showed up at the bus stop, we were all barefoot. Imagine going somewhere barefoot. One fellow got his toilet kit, and when he took out the toothbrush, he didn't know what to do with it. He started brushing his eyebrows. I couldn't make this up. So let's go back to 1937. From hills and plains throughout all the land, people are singing a joyful refrain, smiling and working, a merry youthful band, till happy days are here once again. With joyful voice, we all rejoice, for CCC, up to the skies, our praises rise, for our great country. We believe this land of the free is on the road to prosperity. Hip, hip, hooray for the NRA, Franklin D. and CCC. Hip, hip, hooray! Thank you. In the song, he refers to Franklin D. Of course, that's Franklin Delano Roosevelt. They loved him like a father. NRA stands for National Recovery Act. That was the umbrella organization with many alphabet soup agencies underneath it. And the two big ones was the WPA, Workers' Progress Administration, that employed about 3 million. Those were for the older men. They paid them 15 cents an hour. They repaired city streets, sidewalks, they built post offices, libraries, gyms, city parks, city bridges. But that work was in the town. They went home to their wives and kids at the end of the day. The CCC had 2.6 million nationwide, another 500,000 VCCs, Veteran Conservation Corps members, and those were residential camps like you saw in the video. 200 men in every camp with about 20 officers. They also employed local experienced men. They were building bridges and dams. So they needed, you know, engine mechanics. They needed surveyors and welders and stonemasons and carpenters. And it paid these older men $40 a month to work. And they lived at their homes. They came into the camp every day to work with these young men, to help supervise them. Now, the projects were administered by different federal agencies. The Soil Conservation Service, Department of Grazing out west, out here the Forestry Department, the Parks Department, it depended what they were doing. If they were building parks or planting trees or building roads, the Bureau of Interior, for example. So the federal agencies supervised the work, but when they got back into the camp, they were in the hands of the Army. So it was really a twofold effort there. When they first came to these towns, they were not always welcome. They were called bad names. Cross-country cockroaches. Cross-country crooks. Roughnecks. Wood ticks. The reason? Farmers were jealous and skeptical and suspicious. Imagine you're a farmer scratching out a living here in Ohio, and down the road there's some well-dressed, well-fed young men building roads for $1 a day. Well, why don't I have that job? I should have that job. They're on the dole. And I lost two of my best farmhands to the seas this year, and I resent that. And Saturday night they got in a fight with our local boys at the saloon, those troublemakers. What are they doing in my neck of the woods? And they want to date my daughter? Oh, not on your life. You know, they had plenty of reasons. But let me tell you the good news. the CCs won them over. Because they were Johnny on the spot when emergencies came along. The flood of 37. I think there were 4,800 CCCs involved in the rescue efforts. That's a lot of young men putting their lives on the line. You bet. If there were forest fires, if there were blizzards, tornadoes, just they send them out. A woman in Wisconsin was stuck in a blizzard trying to get to the hospital. She was ready to have a baby. Snowplows were stuck. Who do you call? Those lousy roughnecks. They came out, 80 of them with their shovels, got her to the hospital in time, and the baby boy was born, and everything was fine. In Eagle River, Wisconsin, they saved the lives of 2 children in 1 week from drowning. I saw it in a camp newspaper. A 3-year-old fell off a dam, and a 7-year-old girl fell off a raft. Imagine, they saved the lives of 2 children in 1 community. The goodwill that brought. Every camp had an infirmary, and it was not uncommon for a woman to walk into camp with a sick child, and they never turned them away. They weren't supposed to be clinics, but they helped them out. They'd save their kitchen garbage for farmers. That's a big deal. Kitchen garbage. I remember a fellow coming up to one of my talks. I was just 15. I was too young to be in the C's, but we had a farm just down the road from that CC camp, and I used to drive my dad's Model A pickup truck into that camp every night and dump that old kitchen garbage in the back and home. Man, I tell you, that really helped our family, fed those pigs. He went on to tell me how they knew how hungry his family was, and if they had any leftover food, they'd put newspaper on top of the garbage. He'd take the lid off the garbage can, and there'd be some biscuits or some meat or something. Oh, I tell you, I can't talk about this anymore. He walked, tears were coming down his face. He was very emotional. Yes, they touched people in very positive ways. So those nicknames kind of disappeared. And they won their respect. But, you know, 80 years later, I was up in Hayward, Wisconsin, in a museum, and there was a CCC exhibit. And on the wall was a poem. And the name of the poem, I looked at it, was Wood Ticks. It was about being called Wood Ticks. So I took my camera, I photographed it, and I turned it into a song. And I just want to sing a little verse from it. But it gives a sense from the perspective of a CC boy. Imagine you're a fresh-faced farm boy from Ohio, and you're shipped off to camp, and these fellows will be walking by, a farmhouse with their axes on their shoulder or shovels. And I've heard this from 3 or 4 men. Seriously, the head of the household, the woman would shoo the children in the door when these guys are walking by, and then say, "Wood ticks, filthy wood ticks." That was a very common nickname. Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't very nice. They call us lousy wood ticks who like to drink and fight, but it's where the CCs are when fires break out at night. We are the most unruly crowd the Lord has ever made, but when the flood breaks or the dam at CC, grab your spade. They say we drive our trucks too fast and make a lot of noise, but when some trouble comes your way, it's call the CC boys. They say we're non-supporting and on the relief rolls, but it's hello, Mr. CC man, when we vote at the polls. Oh, call me Cedar Savage, I don't pay it no mind. Call me a brush monkey, you'll never hear me whine. Call me a stump jumper, it won't bother me a bit. But when you call me wood tick, it puts me in a fit. Just don't call me wood tick. Thank you. They had a lot of nicknames. Roosevelt's Tree Army, they planted 3 billion nationwide. Soil Soldiers. Soldiers of Poverty, Boys in Green. My favorite, Dollar a Day Boys. $30 a month they were paid, $1 a day. Now, $1 back then, young lady, was worth $20 today. You could buy a candy bar for a nickel, an ice cream cone for 3 cents, new pair of shoes for $1.50, dozen eggs for 7 cents, 5 gallons of gas for $1. So $1 a day, that's a lot of money. Well, the beauty of the program was $25 was sent home directly to the family. They never saw it. And they had $5 spending money each month. So $25 in those days, that's $500. That's a lot of money for these families. And it changed their lives. And we don't want to forget that in the Depression, many people were too proud to accept relief. They would rather go hungry. They came from the old country. They distrusted government. They hated government. You go away. You take our son to fight in your war. We go hungry. They didn't want any relief. And they would rather starve. And they were starving. But if they had a son out there digging holes or building roads, you better believe it, they accepted that money. We'll never know how many people the CCCs kept from starving. The average CC had six to seven dependents. So if you do the math, that's about 15, 16 million dependents out there. It touched in very positive ways. You see, farmers had food, but they had no money. One fellow told me, he said, well, my dad was a blacksmith. He had all kinds of work, but the farmers couldn't pay their bills. What do you do? I'll never forget an older man coming up after my program. He started shaking my hand and he wouldn't let go. I wasn't in the seas, but my brother was. Had $25 a month, put food on the table for my 11 brothers and sisters. It kept us alive. I'm telling you, it kept us alive. I don't know what we would have done. And tears were coming down his cheeks. People remember what it did for their families. He said his mother had enough money to make a pot of bean soup to take it to the neighbors because their mother had died. And the father had left, I don't know, if the father died, whatever the case, they supported another family next door. Bean soup every day. I mean, these stories you hear all the time. I had a woman tell me yesterday how when she was a little girl, she remembered at Christmas, they got an orange for Christmas. And there were 9 children in her family, and each child got to have one piece of that segment of that orange. I didn't know oranges had that many. Yeah, it was a different time. Another woman told me just last week how the parents always let the children eat their food first at dinner time. And if there was any leftover food, the parents would eat. And she remembered there were many nights when they did not eat. They were grateful for that. Well, job number one here in Ohio was reforestation. You had a lot of burned over, cut over land. The lumberjacks had left a wasteland out there. So the CCCs were planting white pine and jack pine and red pine. You saw in the video they'd plant 1,500 trees in a day. And that's backbreaking work. You come back, I'll never walk straight again. You know, and they would... They would nurse those trees. If they died, they'd go back and replant them. They would water them and take care of them. They planted a lot of black locust trees when they were repairing washed out gullies because those were grew like weeds. They'd retain the soil. Forest fires were also an issue here in the state. Yes, there weren't any real big forests, but people were starting fires because the county paid you 15 cents an hour to fight the fire that you started in the morning. So it was quite common. And by the way, that was another reason for the animosity to the seas, because they were putting out the fires now, and they deprived the locals of some of their income. They couldn't go out and start fires anymore. So that was that creative resentment as well. The seas built the beautiful parks in your state. One of my favorites is Cuyahoga Valley National Park. I was up there about 6 years ago, and they used all that wormy chestnut that had been hit by the blight, and they made a Happy Days Lodge up there. This lodge must be 200 feet long, fantastic, with these huge timbers of that beautiful wormy chestnut. And they called it parkitecture. And so it's a type of architecture that includes, you know, rough aspects of pioneer America, but it's instead of using round logs, they'd be hand-hewn logs, okay, with axe marks. You see the axe marks on these big logs, and you'd swear that they'd been, you know, gone through a sawmill. Now, do you think CCCs did that? No. Lumberjacks. Those were the local experience men. You can't teach a teenager how to turn a round log into a square one like that. No, sir. Of course, John Bryan State Park here. I've got this book you can take a look at afterwards, Our Mark on This Land by Ren and Helen Davis. Documents the destination CCC parks across the country. And in Ohio, the destination parks include John Bryan, which I don't need to tell you about the beautiful fieldstone shelters out there, Jefferson Lake State Park, Cuyahoga Valley, which I just mentioned, and other parks is the Great Circle Earthworks in Newark, Ohio, which was a lot of the work was done by the CCC boys. Now, when I say they built the parks, what does that mean? It means they went out, they surveyed the property, they went out, they cleared out the timber stand improvement, they built parking lots, roads, hiking trails. I mean, just to create a road through some of these parks. Their parks tend to be rugged areas. And some of these places where they built the roads, I mean, they were using dynamite, blasting. These were teenagers. You know, one fellow told me they had a fellow who was really good with the, they called them powder monkeys. He said when they were blowing up roads, stumps to make roads. And he didn't just blow up the stump. He could move that stump 2 feet to the left, 2 feet to the right. He was so talented. Teenagers driving those tractors, those Caterpillar tractors. It was the farm boys that drove the tractors, of course. Everybody wanted to be a tractor driver. They'd park the tractors in a very tight circle, and if you could unpark it, you got the job. That's how they separated the men from the boys. But the CCs came in, and they built these shelter houses, the bath houses, the changing cabins, and in some cases, the lodges. But they used the native stones, whether it was limestone or fieldstone or granite. They would quarry the rock themselves. They would drill into the rock, build fires, heat it up, and then pour cold water down those holes to cause it to fracture. I'm telling you, it's an amazing work, and I'm working on a project for the Indiana State Parks about the CCC's building their parks. They built 8 or 9 parks over there. And these are the kind of things they did, which was just extraordinary. A lot primitive tools, but wonderful craftsmanship. And when you see the beautiful stonework, those are stonemasons. But the Cs, as I said, quarried the rock, they faced, they lined the stone. In my book, I tell the story how this fellow, he faced and lined the stone and gave it to the old stonemason, Mr. Koski, an old Finn. It's perfect, Mr. Koski. He took the stone, tapped it very gently with his hammer. Now it's perfect. It's not perfect till I say it's perfect. So you see the workmanship. You have to remember, it was the CCCs that cut down the trees, that stripped the bark, that shaped it. You know, but it was the lumberjacks, it was the carpenters who put the finished work on it. That's why they're so beautiful and so well made, and those beautiful stone fireplaces that you see all over the country. You know, in Smoky Mountain National Park, there were 24 CCC camps. You know, that's nearly 5,000 young men over a 9-year period. Tremendous effort to build those lookout towers and those roads. What a legacy they've left. Just to touch briefly on other things they did, they built over 2,000 miles of roads in the state of Ohio, put up over 1,800 miles of telephone poles. You know, that bought a lot of goodwill. Telephone service on the boondocks? You bet it did. They restored riverbanks. They timber stand improvement, blister rust eradication. They did surveying across the state. All types of things, animal control. But the work was hard. You know, they worked in the cold. They had a ruling camp. You didn't have to work if it was 20 below zero. One fellow told me, he said, we had a thermometer that was rigged. He said, it didn't go below 19. Oh, by the way, we ought to turn off this lamp here. I didn't realize it was still on. I bet this is it here. Okay, very good. All right. Another fellow told me, 20 below, heck, we worked when it was 35 below. He said we would keep one truck running all night long in the garage and use that truck to jumpstart the other trucks in the morning. But they were pretty good about it. If we showed signs of frostbite, they got us in pretty quickly. And that same fellow told me it was the best year of his life. And young lady, that's an important lesson. Oftentimes the hardest thing you do in life is the best thing that ever you did. You know, whether it's math class or learning the clarinet or playing basketball, if you really work hard, you remember that. At the time, it's not very nice. You got to work hard. But later on, you'll say, wow, that was a great thing. And that's the way it was with these CC guys. How about working in the bug-infested swamps? I had a fellow tell me he was putting up telephone lines in Minnesota. They were getting eaten up by black flies. Imagine, you're on a telephone pole hanging wires and black flies are eating you up. Where do you run? Well, the doctor in camp took pity on him. He mixed this black tar solution with citronella, the plant extract, and they gooped it on their arms and neck and face. He said we were all black-faced. We looked like hell. But it worked. The trouble was the flies stuck to our face. And then they would walk across and tickle our nose. And we couldn't pick them off because we were hanging wires. We had to keep our hands clean. We couldn't get them greasy. How about fighting forest fires? My oldest son started a fire when he was 6. Yeah, it took me a couple hours to put it out. I'll never forget it. I can't imagine spending 8 hours out there. I mean, your eyes, your breathing. And the stories these guys tell me, oh, we jumped in the river. The crown fire went over our heads. Oh, the captain said, run for your lives, you know. And we busted our buddies out with a Caterpillar tractor, save their lives. I mean, these were teenagers. The cold, the heat, the bugs. Why do they do it? Why do they stick it out? Because the money was going home to their families. They were helping their brothers and sisters. They love their brothers and sisters. In fact, one story comes to mind. The cook was throwing out a dozen boxes of stale cereal. Do you know how awful that tastes, stale cereal? Well, he said, can I have it? And he gave it to this young man. He put it in a big sack, gunny sack. It's like a burlap sack. He got permission to go home on the weekend. He hitched a ride on a freight train. This was in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. He rode it for 8 hours in the dead of winter. You know how cold that is? And then when he got near his family's home, he jumped off that moving train. And then he walked 17 miles to his family's home to give his brothers and sisters 12 boxes of stale cereal. You better believe it, they love their families. Yes, they did it for love. That's why they stuck it out. These fellows would get letters from home, and they would cry. Yet these same guys were on the boxing team. They were tough. They all boxed back then. But they had letters home. In my book, I tell the story how a fellow walked in the bunkhouse, and his 20-year-old buddy, Jose, a Mexican youth from Detroit, is sitting on his cot, and he's crying. What are you crying for? And he motions his head, and there's a letter sitting next to him. You want me to read the letter? He picks up the letter. Dear Jose, we're so proud of you and the fine job you're doing. The money that's coming home is really helping us out. It buys us lots of food like beans and cornmeal and sugar. The pantry's so full you wouldn't recognize it. Mama spends a lot of time in the kitchen singing. She's so happy. There was enough money left over from your last check to buy your sister a new Easter dress, a pair of shoes, and an Easter bonnet. I wish you could have seen how pretty she looked at church. We thought of you that day. I'm going to skip ahead because he's trying to guess why he's crying. Oh, I know why you're so unhappy. It's because there wasn't enough money for your parents to buy anything nice for themselves. He wanted his mother and father to buy something other than flour and sugar. Yes, they love their family. That's why they stuck it out. Not all of them stuck it out. I don't want to create it wasn't all hunky-dory. You had a 2 to 5% AWOL because you voluntarily signed, you could voluntarily leave. Some of them left because they missed their mothers. I had a woman in Neenah, Wisconsin tell me, well, I was just 14 years old. I was too young to drive, but my brother wrote and he begged for someone in the family to come visit. And the camp was only 35 miles away. For some reason, her father wouldn't drive her. She said, well, so one Saturday morning, I stole my dad's truck. I didn't have a driver's license, but there I could hardly see over the steering wheel. And my brother drew me a map, and I drove out and visited him, and I picked him up for lunch on Saturday, and I took him into town and bought him lunch. And as she told him stories about the family back home, tears were coming down his cheeks. Tears of happiness. They loved their families. So a lot of the guys left because they missed their mothers. Others couldn't take the hard work. But if you did leave early, if you did go AWOL, the captain would send a telegram to your family and say, "We have a train ticket for your son. He is welcome to come back. He will be punished, but he is welcome back." And many of them did come back. Many of them did come back. Yeah. Oh, they had lots of... Grease pit duty was the worst. It stunk so bad, your clothes stunk. You had to scoop it out and carry it to the dump. Oh, what a... But painting, raking, or you couldn't go into town for a month. Things like that.
Extra duty.
Now, the second reason they stuck it out in camp was the food. Imagine you walk into the mess hall. Above the door it says, "Take all you want, but eat all you take." Oh boy, for breakfast, pancakes, cereal, eggs, ham. Then for lunch, they brought out big pots of stew. Fill up your mess kit twice. Fresh baked bread sliced 2 inches thick. Grab a handful of cookies. Oatmeal, ginger, molasses. Average CC put on 17 pounds in his first year. And that was muscle. For dinner, they always started them off with soup. Vegetable soup. You had to eat your veggies. This rookie came into camp one night. He was on his third bowl of soup. "How come you eating so much soup for?" "Well, I'm hungry." "Well, save some room for supper." "I thought this was supper." "Oh, no, we get dessert too." "Huh? What's dessert?" "Never heard of dessert." Yeah. Now for the main course, oh gosh, pork chops. Virginia baked ham. I never had Virginia baked ham like that in my life. Not much chicken. Corned beef, meatloaf, pot roast, lasagna. It was food that stuck to your ribs. There were cases where the cook was skimming off the top, serving them beans 3 times a week or lots of spaghetti, but those were rarities and they would go on strike and get it corrected. But basically it was good and it was a big supply. Now, every camp had its own baker. Pudding, pie, cake. And gals, if they burned the vanilla pudding, they called it butterscotch. Yeah. Yes?
So, where did you get all this beef and all the corn? And they were running farms, were they?
Good question. They bought it from the local farmers. They bought the leftover produce from farmers, which is even better. They'd come driving in with their cabbages and beets. They'd buy everything. Remember, you've got 225 mouths to feed. That's a lot of food they're going to need. And they had these big root cellars. And after they'd buy other crops, they'd tell the farmers, "Oh, fill up your truck on us. Get yourself some oil and gas as you're going out." That bought a lot of goodwill. And if a farmer hit a deer, bring it in within 24 hours. We'll give you $2 or $3 for it. One farmer used to come in every 2 or 3 weeks with the deer. My friend noticed, he said, "I noticed there weren't any dents on the truck." "Oh, there's the bullet hole." They were just looking the other way. They were just trying to help. It's just amazing. But there were some surprises with the food. One fellow told me they used to bake these big sheet cakes. And one of the guys said, "Hey, there's raisins in this cake." Well, those weren't raisins. Those were cockroaches. They got into the batter. So that kind of stuff happened. Now, there was a saying in camp, life began at 4 o'clock, and that's when the trucks rumbled back into camp. You had about an hour and a half before supper, and they went off to baseball practice or basketball or boxing, play a game of horseshoes with your buddies, shoot some pool up at the pool hall, the rec building, play chess and checkers. They like to play poker, maybe go up and read magazines in the library, write a letter to your girlfriend. Now, if you didn't write a letter, there was always someone who would for 10 cents. Someone who had beautiful penmanship and flowery language. In my video, a fellow tells a story how he wrote the same letter to 3 different girls who lived in the same town. It didn't work out very good, yeah. But a lot of the fellows had angles for making money. You could get a haircut for 10 cents. The fashion of the day were bell bottoms. So for 15 cents, they would slice your pants and sew on a piece of fabric, like blanket, and turn your pants into bell-bottoms. All kinds of things. One fellow was very creative. He built a beehive out of wood, had a little latch door. For a nickel, you could peek inside. And the sign said, rare albino bees. So you look inside, and he had carved out all these letter Bs, which were painted white. So one guy would look, oh, that's really good. The next guy would come up, oh, they wouldn't tell the next guy behind them, you know. A lot of practical joking in those camps. Most of the joking was around your cot, your bed. That's all you had. You had a cot and a footlocker, right? So they short sheet your bed. That's typical. Or they put a frog under your covers or a dead fish. Let's say you're going to bed at night. You went to bed early, okay? You're fast asleep. Well, 2 minutes before lights out, they'd wake you up. Hey, Charlie, you overslept, man. Huh? What? Oh, he'd get up, he'd put his pants on, and put his boots on, and then click, the lights would go out. You know, stuff like that. Or one fellow was sleeping, and they tied a rope around him. And they yelled, fire. That was on really cold nights. They used to put their boots underneath the bed. On cold nights, they put water underneath your boots. They'd be frozen to the floor in the morning. Most of the jokes. There was a lot of wild goose chases. They'd send them off looking for left-handed monkey wrenches, sky hooks, tree squeaks, shorelines. Hey, rookie, get over here. Yeah, sergeant's looking for the paper stretcher. Paper stretcher? What's that? Don't ask questions. Just get over the equipment building. You guys seen the paper stretcher? Well, I was around here a few minutes ago and checked the garage. Have you guys seen the paper stretcher? Well, yeah, I think it's in the supply shack. Back and forth for hours. Virgin oil, cannon reports, pole stretchers, snipe hunting, yeah. But my favorite was always striped paint. Striped paint. It was usually the city boys that fell for this. The farm boys, by the way, didn't fall out. The farm boys, if they left home, it was because they missed their mothers. They could take the work because, as you know, by the time you were 13 or 14, you were working a man's day on the farm. But the city boys had never had that background. They weren't tough. A lot of the camps had mascots, dogs, deer, bear, foxes. They'd find little animals in the woods and raise them, flying squirrels. I've seen them all. Crows. I've run into two camps where they had crows. My favorite is Pete the Deer up at Three Lakes, Wisconsin. They found this big buck. See that picture there? They find a big buck with a broken leg in the woods. They brought him into camp, the doctor set the leg, and they created a harness. And it healed up. And when they let Pete go, he wouldn't go. He was so tame, he'd go up to the kitchen every night and clack its hooves on the steps, demanding his evening supper. And in the summertime, he'd let himself in the bunkhouse door through the screen door, and if the boys' toes were sticking out from underneath the blankets, he'd lick their toes and wake them up in the morning. Oh, these stories. Bear were also very popular because every camp had a garbage pit. That's right. And bears love garbage. For fun, the fellows would put a little molasses in a pail and the bear would lick the molasses and get their head stuck in the pail. Yeah. And you'd have three or four guys with broomsticks waiting to swat the bears behind. That was considered a good afternoon bit of adventure for the fellows. One of my friends told me how they were boiling big pots of water and dipping chickens in it to loosen the feathers. And the cook told him to take the dirty hot water and dump it in the garbage pit, which he did. And he dumped it right on a bear cub's tail, you know. And it started shrieking and humming. Well, who goes out with the bear cubs? The mama bear. The mama bear got up on her hind legs and scared the heck out of them. So I took his story and a couple others, and I made a song called City Slicker. One day a boy was hauling hot water in a pail. He dumped it in a garbage pit right on a bear cub's tail. That baby bear made a shriek that made that boy's eyes wide. Across the pit he saw the mother on the other side. That mother bear growled so loud it made that young man cringe. He ran on back to camp so fast the door fell off its hinge. Yeah. The screen door fell off its hinge. He ran in so fast. Late at night, some dogs chased some boys up a tree. They stayed up in the branches wondering how they'd all get free. In the morning, a local farmer came to their rescue. He was searching for his hunting dog, led by a hound named Blue. Those boys were so embarrassed they had stayed up all the night, running from some friendly dogs that did not want to bite. It was a hot summer night. Four guys snuck out for a swim in the creek. Walking back, they got chased by the neighbor's dogs. Well, they thought those were wolves, so they spent the whole night up in the tree. One day, a CC boy went rabbit hunting with his gun. He was told to look out for a wild boar on the run. As fate would have, he saw that boar and put it in his sight. A single shot took down the beast. They cooked it up that night. A farmer came looking for his pig that had run away. The boys collected some money, paid the farmer that day. That wasn't a wild boar. He shot the neighbor's pig. So they took up a collection, $4, and gave him a blueberry pie and sent him on his way. Oh, come on, all you CC boys, join us in the woods. We'd love to give you company, oh yes, we surely would. We don't care where you have come from, we don't care where you have been. When you come into our forest home, your troubles will begin. Thank you. Well, after dinner, they kept their uniforms on, and they went up to the educational building. At least some of them did, because they brought in unemployed teachers, and they earned their eighth grade certificates, eighth grade diplomas. About 15 to 20% of the CCCs earn their eighth grade diplomas, and they dropped out of school for a lot of reasons, and I've heard them all. You know, my mother died. I had to take care of my siblings. My dad took me out at 15 to work in a scrapyard. My dad kept me on the farm to harvest potatoes. When I finally got into school, I was so far behind I couldn't get caught up. So it gave them a second chance. You know, Monday night, these were two-hour courses. Monday night would be math and English. Tuesday, geography and history. Here's an eighth grade final exam. Here's a math question, and you don't get to use a calculator. If a load of wheat weighs 3,942 pounds, what is its worth at 50 cents a bushel, deducting 1,050 pound for tare? You know, here's a history question. Name the events connected with the following dates: 1607, 1620, 1800, 1849. You know, this is like high school. They were tough. They were very serious. And they took it seriously. They volunteered to take these courses. Now, if you didn't do that, you could take vocational courses. They brought in these local experienced men: welding, engine repair, carpentry, drafting. I've got pictures of the CC boys, you know, 20 guys at drafting tables. Can you imagine that? Learning drafting? And if that wasn't enough, they offered college correspondence courses with Ohio State. Forestry, accounting, business principles. They kept those guys busy in the evenings. And if that wasn't enough, they had a ham radio club, a photography club, newspaper. Like this hooey from the Yellow Springs, you know. We wonder, this is by the owl, okay, we wonder. We wonder where Skinny goes every night, and we wonder if she has any friends. Has she? Why do they call bag ears? Why CLE goes home every weekend? Why, if Brian is a follower of Mussolini's black shirts? Who are the two lonely two CCC boys? Anyway, and wanted. Why does Slim France stick so close to Mr. Winters? Why is the first section always the neatest? Lots of neat humor. And every camp had what they call bunkhouse humor. And a lot of the jokes were around girls. Betty says, I hope everyone notices my new cap. Belinda, then you better lower your skirt 6 inches. This is one of my favorites. A city girl staying in the country became friendly with a young farmer. One evening, as they were strolling across the field, they saw a cow and her calf rubbing noses in an affectionate fashion. Ah, sighed the farmer, that makes me want to do the same. Well, why not, said the girl. It's your cow, isn't it? Here's one for you, young lady. How is a small boy similar to a canoe? They both behave better when paddled from the rear. They had Saturday noon to Sunday curfew off. Saturday morning they had camp cleanup and inspection, and then, but Saturday afternoon, and they loved to go into town, bowling, roller skating, go to the movies. Some went to the saloons, go to the dance halls, go into town on Sunday in church, and they loved to meet the girls. Of course, the girls like to meet the guys, because what happens when your dad says, don't date those CCC boys? What's she going to do? You got it. A fellow told me, you'd be sitting in a movie theater and it'd be kicking on the back of your chair. Hey guys, want to share our popcorn with us? Another told me, well, when I was 15 and 16, we'd go to the theater every Saturday night, wait out on the sidewalk for the CCs to drive up in their trucks, and then we'd pair up with them outside the theater and go in and hold their hands during the movie. I said, that's it? Yeah, they just wanted to hold our hands. Isn't that sweet? Another woman said, well, by the way, a lot of these towns never had dance halls until the CCs came. They were, I mean, dirt poor, these little towns, but you got 200 guys out there with some jingle in their pocket. Well, you take an empty church, empty city hall building, whatever, turn it into a dance hall on Saturday. There were thousands of swing bands touring the country, and it was easy to bring them in. This woman said, well, when I was 17 and 18, I'd go to the dance hall with my girlfriends, and we'd pair up on the dance floor and be dancing. And the CCCs would come in and line up against the wall. And they would buddy up with each other, and they'd send little hand signals. Hey, me and my buddy, can we cut on you two girls? You know, and the girls would be over here. Agnes, I think those two guys want to dance. What do you think? Oh, Betty, I don't know. I'll take the tall one. Okay. And then they go, all right, and the guys would come across and cut in on them. Now, if they didn't want to, they'd just kind of go, no, thank you, you know, and no hurt feelings. You know, they're 20 feet away, you see. It's embarrassing to tap someone and be turned down. So they had a ways to communicate, and beautiful stories. But you had to be smart to get a girl because it was pretty competitive. There were 200 guys in these camps. By the way, not all of them were chasing the girls. For every guy that chased, there were three guys that weren't. You know why? They were shy. I remember I met a fellow in southern Ohio down along the river. Portsmouth, is that the town? Mm-hmm. I'll never forget this guy. I asked him about his, we'd love to go into the bowling, the roller skating rink on Saturday night. I said, really? Did they give you the skates? He said, well, I didn't skate. I said, what? Yeah, I just paid the dime. There was a room you could look through the window at all the roller skaters. I was too shy to talk to the girls. We liked to look at the girls as they were all roller skating. It cost like 20 cents to skate, but just, can you imagine? He said, yeah, none of me and my buddies, we never dated girls. We were too shy. So I don't want to give the impression all these guys were, you know, Sharpies. But you had to be smart. One time these fellows were planting trees, and in the farm field next door, there was a young lady shooting bows and arrows who just kind of showed up, right? Well, his buddy went over during a work break, asked her out to the movies. Well, my dad won't let me go out with CC boys. Yeah, but what if we show up at the movie on the same night? What if we happen to sit next to each other? He got himself a date. Yeah. Another had to drive into town to pick up the mail. every day. He timed his route to go by the high school when the girls were coming out. Pull up to the curb, roll down his window, Mr. Big Shot in his uniform. You know, hey girls. Well, he found out where one young lady went to church on Sunday. Well, guess who started to go to that same church? That became his wife. Yeah. A woman told me her mother was at a community swimming pool. And she and her girlfriend were swimming, and on the deck was a CC drying himself off in the sun. Her mother turned to her girlfriend, "Do you dare me? Do you dare me?" Her mother said, "Yeah, I dare you." So her mother started splashing this defenseless CC boy, who jumped in the water, started wrestling with her. Well, that became her father. That's how her mother met her husband. I can't make this up. But so many wonderful stories how the CCs, in fact, they gave a program in Fishers, Indiana, 3-4 hours ago, and a woman said, "I wouldn't be here if it weren't for the CCCs. My father met my mother at a dance hall, one of those nickel dances. And she didn't really know what that meant, and I explained it to her. They had, you could buy a dance for a nickel. The local high school girls would dress up, put on their pretty chiffon dresses, and they had a little leather pouch which they tied to their left wrist. And you could buy a little ticket for a nickel, like a movie ticket. And you pick out one of these girls, and they had little ribbons to signify which girls you could dance with. You give it to her, and she saved it because she would make 2 or 3 cents a dance. She might make 50 cents on a Saturday. That's like $10. And she said, her dad bought that ticket, and he picked out her mother, and that's how they met. So she was really thrilled to learn how that actually. One fellow told me, he said he was trying to get the attention of a girl, and he was waving like this, and she waved back, but they never hooked up. They never danced. Later on, this young woman came up. "You stood me up. Whatever happened to you?" "Huh?" She said, "Yeah." She said, "I put out 2 fingers. You were my next dance." He didn't know the sign language. So anyway, it's been wonderful talking about the C's. What a legacy they've given us. They gave us our national forests. And you've got several state national forests here in Ohio. Our parks. Many of the county roads you drive on were built by the C's. The telephone poles, the restoration of rivers, and of course the beautiful parks and the structures that are still in use today. What a legacy. Their reward for all this hard work? World War II. Yeah, 84-85% went of the war. I'll never forget a fellow who came up after one of my programs. "I was in the Marines. Half the Marines were CCs. It's why we won the war." He gripped my hand with a vice grip. We don't want to forget that. It's very serious. It did toughen them up. It did prepare them. And by God, they went out and put their lives, and many, many lost their lives. But we remember that generation for their exploits in the Second World War and not what happened before. And so they did so many great things for America. But I'll never forget a woman who came up after one of my talks. She said, "You forgot something very important." I said, "Huh?" She said, "Yeah, the greatest thing the CCCs did for America was give us a lot of great husbands." Thank you very much.